I'm Alexander Norbash, and I have been privileged to serve as the president of the American Rankin Race Society, and this is my presidential lecture. What I'd like to do is share with you the winding and exhilarating road ahead, and how we, as individuals and collectively, can foster a culture of experimentation as we rethink power structures and we ensure inclusion to optimize for our best possible future. In way of disclosure, I'm a scientific advisor to IBM Watson, Stryker, GE, Siemens, and Penumbra, and I co-founded the Boston Imaging Core Laboratories. Those should not affect our conversation today. Our first COVID patient at the University of California, San Diego, was admitted on February 5th, 2020. One of my faculty, Albert Chow, approached me the very day that our first patient was admitted and mentioned that he had an artificial intelligence program in part of his laboratory that he'd been developing, and he had already trained it, I believe, on 40,000 chest x-rays to automatically identify pneumonia. We approached our chief information officer. We took Albert's algorithm, we put it into place, and in less than 10 days from the time that we had our first COVID patient, we had an artificial intelligence automated pneumonia detection system that could even capture pneumonias that would escape the naked eye. Albert was ready. He was ready with a project that he felt he could add value to, even though he didn't have funding. And he communicated that need with us as an organization, and we put it in place. Over the past several years, we've developed some expertise at UC San Diego in quantification. But we know that our radiology reports can be somewhat imprecise. The hyperintensity is next to the brain, the lungs appear over aerated. And we've developed a quantitative approach through collaboration, either collaboration with AMRA in Sweden, where we can do body composition profiling and look at muscle mass or fat throughout the body, or whether collaborating with the University of Washington and looking at proton density fat fractions in the liver using MRI, whether it's MR elastography through collaborations with the Mayo Clinic, or whether it's in-house development of LIRADs and abbreviated MRI sequences. We see collaboration and quantification as essential needs for the future of imaging. We can also see quantification where physiology is concerned. For example, looking at tricuspid regurgitation or aortic valve stenosis. So this allows us to look not just at anatomy, but physiology, or at a molecular level. We can even look at metabolism. That's part of the future of imaging. So when people ask me, where do you think radiology is going? I think there are several areas that radiology is going into. One is ubiquity. Radiology has to be less expensive, easier to use, easier for patients, more automated. There has to be more quantification. We have to be precise, over-aerated, slightly valgus, slightly varus, those are insufficient terms. We like to compare things from one exam to the next. We have to have combinatorial reports that include radiological information, pathological information, and genomic information. And in certain areas, such as breast imaging and breast health, this is slowly becoming a reality. We have to have adaptive care pathways so we understand why we're even getting a CT and what that determines in terms of the next node on either the imaging pathway or the care pathway for the patient. And we need to utilize design engineering. We need to understand what the problems are. We have to solve them in a very organized and structured manner. And so what I'd like to talk about is how I think we can find our way. There are some twists and there are some turns. But the principal question you may ask is, well, let's envision an optimized future. How are we going to get there? And I think we're going to get there by recognizing and promoting a philosophy of conscious experimentalism, by taking chances and learning from those chances, realizing we're not going to succeed in every instance. We'll succeed 5 or 10% of the time, but we have to do so thoughtfully, and we have to do so confidently. We have to leverage innovation. And what that means is we have to value the talent surrounding us. We have to understand who's working with us, who's working next to us, what the value of what they provide is, and how we can leverage that for a better future. And And we also have to rethink power structures and dynamics. We all know that vertical power structures are a thing of the past. And we have to think about how we popularize and we create horizontal power structures. And we will talk about servant leadership briefly. Marie Curie once famously said, "Have no fear of perfection. You will never reach it. Nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood." So we realize that we are on a continuum, driving towards perfection and always improving, but never really achieving perfection in our lifetimes. Everything will change. The way we interact with computers, the way we dress, the way we talk, the way we eat, the way we're healed, everything will change. And we want to contribute to the next step on that evolutionary chain. I was aware of Gene Braunwald at an early stage in my career because he was one of the editors of Harrison's internal medicine textbook. And I learned that he was among the most successful physician scientists ever, the number one author on PubMed out of 42,000 authors. I was at the Brigham and Women's Hospital as chief of neuroradiology from 2000 through 2004, and he was legendary because he had been the chair at Brigham and Women's Hospital for internal medicine from 1972 through 1996. 24 years he had served as the division of medicine chair. Before that, he had been in San Diego as the chair of the Department of Medicine here at San Diego, starting the medical school. And I didn't find out, I've been here at UC San Diego for 6 years, I didn't find out until last year about his wife, Nina Starr Braunwald. Dr. Nina Braunwald, was perhaps the first female cardiac surgeon. She had been chair of cardiac surgery, the service at that point in time, here at the University of California, San Diego, while Dr. Jean Braunwald was chair of medicine. And she was a remarkable woman. She was the first woman diplomat of the American Board of Thoracic Surgery. She performed the first mitral valve replacement at the age of 32. She was the deputy chief of surgery and had a number of innovations to her name, and I had never heard of her. And she was overshadowed by her husband, even though she had every right to be acknowledged. And it reminded me that I cannot take knowledge for granted where knowledge of individual skills and abilities is concerned. If I had a better network, and if I had asked questions about prior leaders, maybe I would have found out about her a little sooner. Maybe others would have found out about her a little bit sooner. And so what we're trying to create as we open our eyes and as we seek and ask about the strengths of those around us and the abilities of those around us, we'd like to understand how we create not just a culture of experimentation, but how we work together more effectively. And part of that is servant leadership. Servant leadership is the realization that leadership systems can be horizontal. They don't have to be vertical. And design thinking, having a method-driven approach to solving problems. Let me start, if I may, with creating a culture of experimentation. As I was sitting at home after the initial steps of the pandemic, it was in March of 2020, I received my latest issue of Harvard Business Review, and I saw on the cover, Creating a Culture of Experimentation. And it laid out a methodical approach to understanding how you can create that culture of experimentation, and it consists of several essential elements. We have to create curiosity as a valued asset among everyone. So we have to cultivate a culture of curiosity. We have to be data-driven and understand that data has primacy over opinions. We need to democratize experimentation so experimentation happens around us, above us, below us. We have to be ethically sensitive and understand that we cannot get swept up in the enthusiasm of the moment. We also have to embrace a different leadership model, a model that welcomes and fosters and develops the opinions of all, not just the few. And so the truth about mistakes and failures for many of us is that we avoid mistakes and we do not like to admit to failures. And it may take a different model for us to be successful in the future and solve the problems that we face currently, in some instances that are unprecedented at a social level. So where mistakes are concerned, we want to learn from them. We have to create learning processes, and we have to effectively communicate the lessons that we learn from each mistake. We also want to avoid needlessly repeating mistakes. And this takes reminder systems. We cannot become inured to making mistakes and creating and engaging in them more frequently. And we have to be particularly mindful of fatal mistakes. And this is part of the culture of experimentalism. Now, as you may have heard, Thomas Edison famously said, "I have not failed 700 times. I've succeeded in proving that those 700 ways will not work." So we need to rethink how we look at failure. Failure is not that was avoidable and it shouldn't have happened. Failure should be, now I've understood, now I've learned from that failure, let me move forward. So moving down the ladder of what we need to create in order to be an experimentalistic culture, I mentioned earlier that data should have primacy over opinion. And if we want to build a data-driven culture, that's going to necessitate a few measures we take. The first is we have to ensure the fidelity of data. We have to be able to distribute data to all, and that data should be in an understandable format. We see this, for example, in quality initiatives in some of our departments, where you may have 15, 20, 30, 35 key performance indicators, and the data is neither easily available, sometimes it's not credible or believed, and it's not understandable necessarily when you see how it's graphed and how it's plotted. So data has to be ergonomic. And we have to have clarity regarding principal data goals. I mentioned that experimentation has to be democratized. What does that mean? That means everyone's opinions where experimentalism are concerned should be listened to. The transporter who transports your patients may have some great ideas about where you can locate a bed park, or how they should be contacted, or when they should be called, or what the problem is with turnaround time from the transporter's perspective. The same thing applies to the technologist. The same thing applies to your frontline nurse. Listen to everyone around you. Encourage their input and democratize experimentation. Experimentation is not something that happens only at the upper levels of an administration. It should be throughout an organization. It's important to keep in mind that the way we do this is by encouraging differences of opinion that are respectfully discussed. To shut someone down through the force of your stature, that creates unidirectional information flow. You have to be able to transmit and receive equally. If you're not communicating, you're not contributing. And if you're not receiving, the other party is not given an opportunity to contribute to a solution or solution finding. So we need to encourage respectful disagreement. We also have to understand that most experiments fail, but the few that succeed allow us to move forward. And there has to be a significant denominator for us to have successful numerators. So democratize experimentation. I mentioned earlier, we have to be ethically sensitive. The ethical consequences and range of experimentalism have to be appreciated by management, creating ethical structures, and by membership that appreciate the need for being ethically sensitive. Again, each of us knows of multiple instances where experimentation takes place, for example, without the necessary engagement of an IRB, without involvement of other individuals. So there has to be a structure to experimentation, and there has to be an ethical construct that stays us when we're moving into an uncomfortable space. So again, to summarize experimentalism, we have to be able to cultivate curiosity. We have to be data-driven and understand data's primacy. We have to democratize experimentation, and experiments have to be run by all in an organization. We have to be ethically sensitive and create an ethical framework, and we need to understand a different leadership model is necessary. So let's focus on that leadership model question for a moment, if we can. Consider the power structures that we classically have put into place and where we are now moving as society changes in certain indelible ways. Power structures that are vertical hold us back. And famously, in December 2014, a Harvard Business Review article came out that talked about understanding new power. Old power is hierarchical, it's jealously guarded. New power is made up of many, it's open, and it's participatory. So let's describe what's happening with new power structures. You see a staircase here, a staircase that talks about progressively greater degrees of incorporation of new power into deliverables. We start with consumption. We move forward to sharing and shaping ideas, then remixing ideas, investing with your own money, moving slowly to having customization of products and services like Etsy, And finally, co-ownership. And examples of recent phenomena, Facebook is an example of sharing and shaping, crowdfunding of funding, YouTube of producing, and Wikipedia of co-owning. And to move into this space, to effectively understand how we create co-ownership models and we effectively develop talents, it's interesting and opportunistic to look at the most horizontal version of leadership, which is servant leadership. And servant leadership is a term that was popularized by Robert Greenleaf, a management guru, and he picked it up from Hermann Hesse. Hermann Hesse was a Nobel Prize winner in literature in 1946. He wrote a book, Journey to the East, and his own initials were utilized for the narrator, HH. HH describes a group that is on a mythical journey looking for perfection and excellence. And among this group is an individual Leo. And Leo will do any task that's too menial for others to engage in. Leo will do it with an elevated and a buoyant spirit and an attitude that is phenomenal and always positive. Well, the end of the story is that Leo actually is the leader to be emulated, and he was the head of this giant secret organization that the journey was directed at discovering and understanding and affecting. And so through service is where excellence can be found and discovered. And that's where leaders are distinguished. Exceptional leaders are interested in serving, not self-promoting. An effective servant leader is focused on serving rather than thriving independently within an organization. That individual shares power, does not hoard it. And the needs and the growth of the employees comes first. And so what are the characteristics of that leader? That servant leader is able to listen and empathize, to be aware, to persuade, understands their role in stewardship. They can conceptualize and think strategically, but they also possess those personal characteristics that are really valuable, and they are external facing. They're committed to the growth of people and communities. How do we develop servant leaders? We have to develop these character traits in our proteges and in our future leaders. And so we need to commit to a different leadership model. We need to create systems that allow large-scale experimentation, and we need to set up grand challenges that allow us to identify and promote these leadership traits. As we seek to optimize transformation, we have to create a culture of experimentalism, accepting failures and mistakes by employing and engaging and creating giant teams with all the individuals who are around us. So we've talked about leadership, and we've talked about a culture of experimentalism. There's a third ingredient to today's talk that I think we can focus on, and that is design thinking. So being structured in terms of how we approach problem solving. Herbert Simon was a fascinating individual who lived between very divergent fields. He was an expert at psychology, economics, sociology, and computer science. And so that gave him a chance to be extremely innovative. And he brought up the space of design thinking as a process-based mechanism when he thought of design thinking as having two components. It needed to have a framework and a cognitive component in terms of what are the processes. It also needed to have an imaginative component where innovation was fostered and that you can make intuitive jumps. So design thinking presumes that our initial solution to a problem may be inadequate. It allows us to observe and develop empathy with target users, to reframe the problem in human-centric ways, to brainstorm, prototype, test, and implement. And there are certain stages to design thinking. The first stage is to empathize with the users, to truly understand the frustrations of the user and what the user is looking for and anticipating as a solution. The second is to go through a process of defining the user's needs, explaining and defining the problem, and then adding insights. The third stage is innovating and ideating, coming up with prototypes next, and then iterating those prototypes through a testing and learning process to ultimately arrive at a solution. So let's elaborate a little bit on empathy if we can. Sympathy is when you feel pity and sorrow for someone else's misfortune. You understand what they're going through and you have a common feeling, a shared feeling. Empathy is when you inhabit their sense more fully. It's being in their skin. Understanding and sharing the feelings of another, and the only way this happens is through communication and spending a little bit of time with that end user. Understanding the range of their frustrations and why they are frustrated and how that comes in direct conflict with their motivation and their ethic about why they do what they do. Paul Yock is a cardiology professor at Stanford who thought up, created, and implemented the Stanford Biodesign course, which is very famous. And this is a Stanford Biodesign textbook. And there are several distinct parts to biodesign. Needs finding and need screening, both of which fall under identification, concept generation or solution finding, and concept screening, both of which fall under the invention flag, strategy development and business planning, which fall under implementation. And by applying these principles, we can expediently formulate better solutions than we otherwise would by accidentally bumbling through one solution after another that are accidentally chanced across. Let me describe a pathway that was done without a design engineering approach, and then I will describe a pathway that led to a solution derived through a design engineering approach. I'd like to describe how we arrived at our current most popular method for treating strokes, which is novel and innovative. But it took a long and circuitous course that lasted a very long time. You might say it lasted nearly 30 years. Dr. Dodder in Oregon accidentally recanalized an iliac artery and realized he could do this intentionally. He came up with a method of doddering using progressively larger catheters to squish atheroma against the wall. Grunzig, 14 years later, came up with the idea of having a balloon that you would inflate inside a vessel that would then compress the atheroma. The first intrabiliary stent was invented in 1980, the first self-expanding wall stent in 1986, the first Palmaz balloon-mounted stent in 1987. Here you see a self-expanding stent where you pull back a sleeve and the stent expands. This was reappropriated for intravascular use, even though this was intended for intrabiliary use. And here you see an example of a Palmaz stent, letter A, which is crimped down on a balloon. The balloon expands, the stent expands, the balloon is deflated, the stent stays in place. We started utilizing this in various parts of the circulation. And in 1991 at Stanford, we were doing some of the earliest carotid stenting procedures. The procedures became more refined to where we came up with protective devices, and we went further and further downstream into the smaller circulation until eventually we had invented a small stent as a field. We invented a small stent that was on a detachable wire intended for intracranial stenting. Well, someone in Germany reappropriated utilizing that stent on a stick to actually engage clot in the middle cerebral artery, expand the stent, and use the stick to drag the clot out of the brain. So it took 50 years of development time from 1963 to 2014 for us to discover, hey, maybe something that expands in a blood vessel could be utilized to remove a clot that's causing a stroke. It took a really long time. We have a good solution now. It's not perfect. It's really good. Let me contrast that, if I may, with a Guglielmi detachable coil. Guglielmi is in the picture on the left with the slinky around his neck. And his colleagues, Fernando Vinuela, is on the far left, Gary Duckweiler standing next to Guido. And Guido had an idea. He thought, you know, we have a lot of coils that we push through catheters in the intracranial circulation. Guido's a neuroradiologist at Sapienza, University of Rome. And Guido thought, wouldn't it be great if we could attach a micro wire to the coils, put them in place one at a time, and detach them only when they are effectively positioned? And so Ivan Sapudka on the far right on this picture is a brilliant, brilliant engineer. And Eric Engelson, who you see in the lower part of the slide, was an engineer who had developed a three-part ultrasoft catheter. And together, over the course of 2 years, they came up with a Guglielmi detachable coil. I seriously hope that Guido gets the Nobel Prize for this, that has revolutionized the treatment of intracranial aneurysms. So what did we learn by thinking about experimentalism and thinking of how we structure it and how we approach design engineering? Well, experimentalism is testing as a way of life. We have to avoid fatal mistakes, learn from every mistake, and have a sense of adventure. We need to tap into collective wisdom by understanding that we want to create an environment that respects all. We have to understand the value of the intellectual biodiversity that's around us. We have to create an environment of safety where differences of opinion can be shared without the brilliant idea being shut down by an authority or a power rating. We have to harness dialogue so that we can iterate. We have to transmit and receive. And we have to develop a just culture where you give people what they need to succeed and you allow open communication and conversation to be less interested in fault and more interested in success and arriving at a destination. And so a heterogeneous team can be a remarkable team. And actually, the more heterogeneous the team, the more wonderful it may be. So as an individual, we have to commit to being full of wonder, always, never jaded, never pessimistic, always optimistic, elevating our vision, moving forward, and motivated by a sense of wonder. We have to feed our curiosity. We have to discover our community. Who is around us? What ideas do they have? How can we tap into each other's ideas with a sense of dialogue to move forward and to participate in the genesis of solutions? We have to learn about processes because processes are essential to creating successful enterprises. And we have to live, eat, and breathe experimentalism. And if we do that, the pathway to the future, it may be circuitous, but it will be something to behold. And it will take us to a wonderful destination. Thank you.